Even if you don't know a lot about Van Morrison, you probably at least know this song. But the real fans of the Irish singer-songwriter know his best work came a year later, when, as my next guest writes, Morrison planned, shaped, and rehearsed the album Astral Weeks right here in Boston with songs like Sweet Thing, Beside You, and the title track. If I'm bending in the slipstream, whenever there's your dream, or a moving steam rims crack, you'll get this in the back road stuff. I really love that song. The album, which Morrison re-recorded live in 2008, traded the electric and repetitive pop sound of Brown Eyed Girl for a return to his jazz and blues roots, coming out the same year as the mega-popular White Album from the Beatles, Jimi Hendrix, Electric Ladyland, The Stones' Beggar's Banquet, Aretha Franklin's Lady Soul, and Simon Garfunkel's Bookends. In the minds of many, Astral Weeks topped them all, leaving a lasting mark on fans and musicians alike, including Ryan Walsh. Ryan's the author of the aptly named Astral Weeks, The Secret History of 1968, with untold stories of how 68 Boston and an incredible cast of characters helped make it all happen. He's also a journalist and the frontman for local band Hallelujah, The Hills. Ryan, it's great to see you.
Thanks for having me.
Congratulations. So this doesn't matter at all unless people buy into the notion that this is one of the greatest albums of all time. So for the uninitiated,
right,
why is it? And I'm with you, by the way.
And that's true, and that's why it makes sense that I could, you know, I wrote it this year. It took that long for everyone to get on board with this record. It's the ultimate slow burn. You know, it wasn't even in stores when it was released. It took decades for people to kind of lionize it.
But why is it at the top of so many people's list, ahead of some of the great, great albums of all time?
Just because there's something very mysterious and unknowable about it. You couldn't even tell what year it was recorded if someone played it to you out of context. And the emotions and the music are just so beautiful and timeless. Yeah.
So it's ultimately recorded in New York, but as
right.
you wrote, planned, shaped, and rehearsed in Boston and Cambridge. What does
right.
that mean? What was planned, shaping mean?
So when Van Morrison arrived in Cambridge in early 1968, he had just come off Brown Eyed Girl and working with Burt Burns. Burt Burns had passed away from a heart attack, and now some unseemly gentlemen were in charge of Van Morrison in New York. One smashed a guitar over his head.
That's why he left, running
right.
away from the mob,
so,
wasn't it?
Yeah.
Wasn't that literally why he left New York?
It's true.
Okay, at 22 years old.
Yes.
Okay.
And he's seeing no money from Brown Eyed Girl, and he doesn't want to be a pop star. He wants to be a poet. And so in Boston, he kind of cycles through three distinct lineups of Boston musicians. He calls all of them the Van Morrison controversy. Mm-hmm. And somewhere in the middle of the summer, this strange switch from electric pop to acoustic happens.
Can we stay with the mob for a second? He literally was running away from the mob.
Yeah.
And then he paid off the mob here, right? Describe that scene.
Well, Joe Smith from Warner Brothers, who's a Massachusetts native, he ended up trying to figure out, how do I sign Van Morrison? And the answer was, go to this warehouse in Manhattan with a sack full of $20,000
right?
and drop it in front of two gentlemen. And I said, did you ever speak to those gentlemen again? He said, no, they weren't in the music business.
That's right. So is it true that he said he had a dream in the middle of this whole thing?
Right.
There'd be no more electric instruments. Is that apocryphal or is that real?
According to his teenage guitarist, John Sheldon, that was how the switch was made. And I was fascinated by that. And I kept asking everyone, you know, do you remember the dream? Do you not remember the dream? Everyone has different memories. But John's version was Van came to practice, said, no more electric instruments, and kicked out the drummer.
You know, I'm going to do a little name association thing with you. I'm
sure.
going to mention somebody
right.
who was a big-time player in 1968 Boston, some directly with Van Morrison, some just in the environment that you paint beautifully here. And give me a sentence or two. Peter Wolf, who's been on the show, most people know him from Jay Giles. A lot of people know him from his WBCN days. Peter Wolf.
Peter Wolf was basically Van Morrison's best friend here in Boston. I mean, they stayed up all night together doing DJ shifts at WBCN. Peter was letting Van borrow his phone because they didn't have a phone at their apartment. And he was helping him get gigs and getting back on his feet.
And Lou Reed, who I thought was solely a creature of New York City. How
right.
wrong was I?
Well, as I came to learn in the research for the book, at a certain point, the Velvet Underground said no more New York and played Boston, I think 73 times in 3 years with like no New York shows.
So he was a major, Lou Reed was a major presence here at that time.
He was. He was always at the Tea Party and yeah.
And one of my great jealousies of the work you did in the book, you got to meet the great Janet Planet. I know Planet is not her real life thing. We'll call her Janet Planet, who was his girlfriend and wife, right?
Right before they moved, they got married. So they were freshly wed.
And what was it, look on your face. What was it like when you sat down? Where was she, in upstate New York or something? Where'd you meet her?
No, we did it by email.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, but she's in California.
And what is she like? I mean, well, can you get a sense from email? Most of us remember her from decades ago.
Right. Well, she was writing liner notes. She was on the covers. She was part of it. I was so impressed by her because, you know, she has a lot to be perhaps bitter about. But she just spoke about how beautiful that time was and they were working on things together. And, you know, I think she has the quote of the book, which is, being a muse is a terrible job and the pay is lousy.
I love that. So let's mention someone lower profile that has a connection here. Who is David Silver? My guess is most people watching the show have no idea who I'm talking about. Who is he?
Well, David Silver used to haunt the very airwaves that we're on now.
Yeah.
In 67, director Fred Barzyk and Silver teamed up to make a show to appeal to the psychedelic youth. And Total Mayhem was aired a couple times a week on GBH.
And it was on 30 sometimes. And it had some pretty prominent people on it, too. Right?
Sure, yeah. Eartha Kitt was a guest. Andy Warhol. Yeah, I mean,
whatever happened to him? You know, the thing was amazing. Van Morrison, I obviously never met him, and you didn't either. We'll mention that in a second. Everybody knows how unsociable he was. I've seen him play at the front on a stage. He goes to New York to do this album, and this is another one I almost couldn't believe. He doesn't, not only does he not talk to the players in advance,
right.
He doesn't talk to them essentially during the recording of the album. They don't know from anything, even who this Brown Eyed Girl, and he was with them doing Gloria before.
Right.
Is that real? I mean, he literally just goes into the sound booth and starts strumming his guitar and they start playing? Is that how this CD happened, album happened?
It's really true. He was not communicative. He wasn't explaining what he wanted. And that's, I think, the happy accident here, is that these musicians were so brilliant that they just heard the emotion in his songs and filled them out with
And excitement. He wouldn't talk to you. He's a Howard Hughesian kind of character, right? I mean, he doesn't talk to anybody, does he?
Well, he'll do a few interviews when a new album comes out, but attempts to reach him on our part.
You know he's in Boston next week.
That's right. He's playing here next week.
Has he read the book, do you know?
I do not think so. I don't know, though.
Why don't you just go on it's Tuesday night. Why don't you go Tuesday night and go find him?
I could maybe throw the book on stage.
I'm serious. Don't you have a great... Don't you feel like you know... I mean, don't you feel like you have an intimate relationship with this guy?
Well, I have an intimate relationship with his songs, and there's always that important difference between the songs and the person, and I think he would be the first one to get mad about people confusing the two.
I hesitate to say this, but I think I love this album as much as you do. It's a pleasure, Ryan.
Thank you so much.
Great.
I really
appreciate
it.
Ryan Walsh, read the book. It's wonderful. It's called Astral Weeks.